Yeah, so yesterday, as it was explained that in traditional network, we were having like all our remote sites data was coming to data center, and then from data center, it was exiting as per the application. Or so if we are having anything for we want to reach to internet, then also the traffic would be coming to data center and will exit from data center. And for any SaaS applications as well, traffic would come to data center, or for any other application which is hosted in data center, that also would be accessed directly through data center. But in SD-WAN, we are having the difference is that that if we want so whatever applications are hosted in data center, that can be we can have exit connectivity directly to the data center. But if you want to reach anywhere, like somewhere on the cloud, SaaS cloud, or you want to reach the internet, we could have the local breakout as well. So it is efficient that in a sense that we don't have to send the entire data to our data center and then go from here. As per our requirement, if our application is SaaS, which is actually accessible through internet, we can, or if we want to access anything web traffic or internet, then we could have local exit, and we will go to data center only, and only if we want to have some access to the application which are hosted in data center. We are having different options like 3G, 4G, 5G is the new thing which is coming. So based on the respective of the underlying transport, our campus sites would be able to reach to the data center. So that is the benefit of SD-WAN. And then it like It, and we can have any kind of service access, like if we want to connect to any cloud service, if we want to cloud any like any application in the data center, or if simply we want to reach to internet. So based on our requirement, SD-WAN provides the integration in efficient way. Okay. Any questions? So in SD-WAN, so it was explained that as in router, we are having three different planes. There is a management connectivity management interface for managing the devices. And then there is one like a control plane in the router. And then we are having data plane. So when we say data plane, we talk about all the ports and interfaces on the router. And control plane is kind of your soup engines, which actually run the routing protocols and learn all the routes. And so what we are doing, just we are opening the router wide open, and we are assigning each role to one dedicated device. So the management role is taken by vManage, and the routing role, which is done by the control plane of a router, is taken by vSmart. And then we are having dedicated vEdge routers on the branch sites, which actually helps us to the transmit data between different sites. Okay. Then there is one orchestration plane, which helps to authenticate different like all the devices. So considering this way that if any unknown device joins the domain, okay, so it has to first authenticate to vBond. And if it is so vBond, we will upload some like one file which would contain the serial number of all the branch like all the vEdges and vManage and vSmart. If any other device which is not having their serial number listed on vBond, try to reach the vBond, it would not be authenticated, and hence it would not be able to join a particular organization's routing domain. Okay, so vbond is kind of authenticator. Also, like once the v edges and v manage and v smart are authenticated, vbond tells about the IP addresses to each other. So vbond would tell v manage and v smart IP addresses to v edges and vice versa, so that v edge knows about what are the v manage and v smart. So once v edges knows those IPs, they can form the tunnel for the further communication. Okay, any questions? Okay, so as you can see here, anything, so we are having underlying, you can see that all our V edges would be either deployed on branch sites, campus, data centers, and cloud. Okay, so these V edges, first they will try to reach using the transport to vbond. So vbond, so based on the deployment model, either vbond be deployed in the cloud and would be reachable through internet, or a vbond would be deployed on-prem. If it is deployed on-prem, there could be different ways to reach vbond. There could be, so if consider if you are having on-prem data center, on-premises data center, and then there is a MPLS link between your branch site and your data center. So in that case, your branch site would be able to reach vbond using MPLS. Okay, so once as it reaches the vbond, so as yesterday in the configuration it was explained that we will configure the system wide configuration on each v edge, like on all the devices we will add the system wide configuration, and we will add the org name and org name, the vbond name, so that once device comes online, it knows what is the vbond IP or vbond name to which it can reach. So once it knows the IP address, it will try to reach to the vbond. And if vbond knows about this device, it has already its serial number recorded. So it will simply authenticate, and obviously it will check the org name as well. And once org name and serial number matches, vbond will authenticate that device. And similarly, device will also authenticate vbond, because under vbond as well, we will configure the org ID, organization name, and basis on the organization name, branch device also authenticate vbond. So it is bi-directional authentication. Vbond authenticates vh and vh authenticates vbond. So once this authentication is done, the device will form the DTLS tunnel with vbond. Okay, and then further, as I explained, that vbond would share the vmanage and vsmart IP addresses, which it already has, and then vedges will form tunnels with vmanage and vsmart too. So these tunnels would be either TLS or DTLS tunnels. Okay. So the difference between TLS and DTLS tunnel is that TLS tunnel is TCP based tunnel, while DTLS is UDP based tunnel. Any questions on this slide, or should we go ahead? Okay. Okay, so basically we are having two type of deployment models. As you can see, one is like on-prem deployment. So in on-prem deployment, we would be managing our vmanage, vbond, and vsmart. So we would so these would be virtual images. So anything like vbond or vmanage or vsmart, these are the virtual images always. Okay. So if it is on-prem deployment, we would be having a management of these. We would be responsible for managing all these devices. So it is anything that the configuration related to the certification, related to the maintenance, upgradation, or backup of these devices. B, like a customer would be who is deploying these devices on on-prem deployment. He would be the own like sole responsible for, yeah. Okay, I think I have a question from someone. What is one-time job for each device? Yeah, that is correct, Sarabjit. So once device is authenticated on VBond and it knows the IP address, so VBond is the sole device which is actually taking care of authentication. Each device will authenticate to VBond. Once it is authenticated, then it will simply connect to the vManage and vSmart based on the IP addresses. There won't be any further authentication. Okay. And then there is one question, VBond like ICE. VBond is, ICE is different. VBond is a separate, a different device, which is only used in SD-WAN environment. Okay. So it is a different device than ICE. If any device restarts, then authentication. Yeah, so it depends. So once authentication is done on VBond, then device will keep running. But as you're saying, if device restarts, it has to again re-authenticate itself with VBond. So every time a VH device goes down and it comes up, or the even the link it has reachability to VBond that goes down, and it links come up again. Again, VS device has to re-authenticate with VBond. Okay. So as you can see, we are having seen on-prem deployment. As I explained, these devices like vManage, VBond, and vSmart are virtual virtual devices. So they has to be deployed on a hypervisor. So we could have an physical underlying physical server from any company, from like HP or anything. So we on top of that physical server, we would deploy something called as hypervisor images. And these hypervisor images could be different. It could be ESXi from VMware or KVM. Okay, so once these images are hypervisor images are deployed, we can deploy the host images for vManage, VBond, and vSmart over it. So it would be kind of so it depends. Like so, hypervisors provides a redundancy here that we can have different host on the same physical server, or there could be different physical server as well. So there is a concept called vMotion where consider if your one physical underlying physical server goes down, then your host which were deployed on that particular physical server, they automatically move to the second physical server. So there is no downtime in that case. The concept called as vMotion. Okay, so we could have multiple physical servers underlying, if like we could have two if we want to have redundancy, or based on how the setup is it if the setup is too big, we want to have multiple vSmarts and multiple vManages, then we could have even three physical servers, and then on each physical server we can have a different host, like one vManage we can deploy as a host on all three physical servers, so that we have redundancy. So this is the on-prem deployment. So as I said, for on-prem deployment, we have to do everything. We have to assign what IP addresses we are going to configure on vManage, VBond, or vSmart. And so we have to plan it. We have to design everything in prior, and then we have to configure. So we would be responsible for everything. Cisco will not do anything in this case. And then second solution could be the cloud hosted, where so in cloud hosted also there are two different solutions. But majorly cloud hosted is solution is provided by Cisco, where they would be taking care of deploying vManage, vBond, and vSmart controllers on their like on our behalf. Okay. Now Cisco also, when I am saying Cisco also has contract with Azure on AWS, where they would deploy their these devices for that customer on these clouds. Okay. And then in cloud hosted, there is another option where there could be a third party provider. He would be like on behalf of Cisco would be providing services. And based on like the contract, either we would be deploying it or they themselves will be deploying it. Okay. Now from management perspective, we would also have access to all the three devices. So if you want to make the changes on anything on vManage, we would have access to make the changes. Okay. Any questions here? Okay. Fourth is one. Okay. Yeah. So you ask if link flaps, then if link flaps, then also we lose the reachability, and then authentication will happen. Like every time link flaps, then it has to be authenticated. Yeah, I will see info border. Yeah. So it does not matter if it is on-prem deployment or cloud deployment. vManage would behave similarly. It would be same kind of image, and GUI representation would be same. It won't be any difference from the structure of vManage and what options you get to configure from vManage. It would be same whether it is cloud hosted or it is on-prem deployment. Only difference comes is that in case of cloud hosted, if it is Cisco who is providing the service, then Cisco would be monitoring your vManage. If all these boxes, vManage, vBond, and vSmart, and if there is a requirement to have more kind of the device is taking more CPU or more memory, then they will do. They could deploy the multiple instances so that they can manage the load on automatically, dynamically on the cloud. While in case of physical server, in case of on-prem deployment, if we see that the existing boxes are going out of capacity, we have to deploy more boxes. So it is us who would be monitoring everything in on deployment. We would be doing everything like taking backups, upgrading, bug fixing. But in case of cloud hosted, everything would be taken care of. So again, if it is Cisco who is giving this service, Cisco would take care of everything. Okay, any further questions? Okay.
Hi, Ujul.
Hi.
Yeah, so hi guys. So my setup is ready, and Ujul has given the overview, and this overview I have also given in the past class. Okay, and if this is your first class, still you got the idea like how we configure this. Okay, and let me share my screen. I'm getting my voice back. Okay, so yesterday, like guys, this was the lab we tried to set up. Okay, so we are going. Can you please confirm if you are able to see my screen? Hello. Okay, thanks everyone. Okay, so let me share the configuration, how we are going to access the vManager. Okay, so you can see we have three devices, vManager, vSmart, and vBond. and we are going to do the basic configuration of all the devices. So yesterday also we have given the same basic setup commands. Let me do it again for you. Okay, so those who are very new here, so when you are going to enable this vManager, okay, so this vManager is going to prompt you like this. Okay, and you need to log in with admin and admin. Okay, it will ask you username, password. The username is admin, password is admin. Okay, so how we are going to set up this? So there is a config which I missed you to share, but today I'll share with you. Okay, so you will go to the config mode and then you will type system and the host name you want to give like vManage. So system IP, this is like your router IP, router ID. Okay, site ID, location, you can give any number. It can vary from 0 to a very big number, 4294967. So you can give any ID. Like suppose this is your headquarter, then you can have site ID 1. Okay, and organization name, you will type NW Kings. And click clock time zone would be your Asia, Kolkata. So this is the first basic step. This is already done. And vBond IP, on all the devices, we need to give the vBond IP. And the vBond IP was 192.168.5.3. Okay, and that's it. And you save it. And now you need to give the IP address on this interface. So by default, this interface is in VPN0. Okay, so what you have to go, like there are two VPNs by default on this devices, like VPN 512, which is you can see this VPN 512, that is a management VPN. Okay, so the management VPN hai, that is 512, and VPN 0 is your transport VPN. Like if you want to do any management thing, you will configure VPN 512. So this is why I have given the name here. Okay, you can see even the switch name is 512 in my case. Because I just wanted to explain you this, that this area is my 512 area. This is called VPN 512. So on all the three interfaces, I want to add them into 512. But by default, all these interfaces are in VPN 0. VPN 0 is also by default. So you have already two VPNs in your controllers, VPN 512 and VPN 0. So whenever you want to do the management part, you will put everything on those interface into VPN V2. Okay, so how to do that? Okay, so you will go to VPN 0. Okay, you will type no interface. You will give the no interface command and you remove the Ethernet 0 from VPN 0. And then you will go to VPN 512. Because we want to configure this interface in 512. Okay, and you give IP address, the same IP add 192.168, like 5 dot whatever IP, like in my case, I have given 5.1/24. Okay, just hold on. I need to go interface Ethernet 0. Okay, IP address 192.168.5.1/24, no shutdown, and then you give the commit command. Okay, so once you do this, so you check the command with the show interfaces description. This is the main command. So now you can see that the system router ID, or you can say system ID is 1.1.1.1. I have not given IP to this Ethernet interface right now because I'm going to set up the VPN management. VPN 512 is the management VPN. Okay. Yes, Shahid. I'll take your question. Just hold on. Or you can ask in the chat. Okay. So this is how you are going to configure. And you can see this Windows PC, this Windows server. Okay, this Windows server is here and I'm going to open this. This is how you are going to open it. And I've already given the IP to this machine. So let me show you how to give IP. It's very basic. You go to your network adapters. Okay, in the network adapters, you give the normal static IP. So I'm giving this machine 192.168.5.4 and the default subnet of class C. And I'm just putting my gateway as 5.1, which is VBOND, but normally you can ignore the default gateway as well. Okay, so your Windows server, this Windows server has two connections. One is from internet, one is going to this VPN 512. And obviously, you know that if you want to put multiple devices in one network, you will have a switch. Okay, so this Windows server is having IP address 5.4. Which IP? This Windows server, I'm assigning 5.4 IP. Let me write over here so that it will be easy for you all to do the configuration when you are going to configure this. So 5.4. So I have already assigned. And you can see I have given the basic commands in vManager. Okay, so just one more minute. So SD-WAN. Okay, so this is the basic PDF which I have created, and you can use the same one for your lab. Okay, so I'll share this PDF with you. Okay, don't worry, I'll share this configuration with you. Okay, so you can see this configuration. This is the normal configuration. When we give the system ID, host name, and then the organization name, the site ID, VBOND, IP address, this is basic config, and then you set up your VPN configuration. Okay, so my VPN was 512. Okay, so I have given this configuration that go to VPN 512 and then you configure the interface, then give the IP, no shutdown, that's it. And now after this, go to this Windows server, assign the IP address, and once you assign the IP, try to ping the vManage IP. So what is the vManage IP? 192.168.5.1, and you can see I'm getting a ping response from the vManager. So hume yahan pe vManager se ping mil raha hai, right? Because my Windows server, my Windows server and my vManager is in same network. You can see this is a switch. Okay, so it's very simple. Okay, and how we are going to access the vManager now? So you are going to type here 192.168.5.1 and it will give you prompt. Okay, so I have already logged in, but let me log out from here. So I'll show you. So you can sign out from here. So when you are going to access this, it will give you this prompt. Okay, whenever you will be accessing for the first time, guys, you will get an error also, maybe that is called HTTPS error. So you just need to allow that error. Okay, sometimes you open HTTPS. So just allow and put admin your username password. So boom, we are inside the vManage now. Okay. So this is, we are going to spend almost all our time in this device that is called vManage. And the first thing you will enter into this vManage, you will go to this, the last option you can see here in this where you see the user icons. So inside this, you can see administration and there is a setting, right? So under settings, you go and check if the details are properly configured. So you can see my organization name is NW Kings. And if VBOND is not set, you can set the VBOND again from here. Like my VBOND IP was 5.3. Okay, save. So you can see easily we can save the VBOND IP. So, and the most important thing here is that like there is many options. Right? Can you see that? There are multiple options. Okay. So here, So this is the most important thing, which is called controller certificate authorization. So Ujjwal has explained that mostly companies are going to have the Symantec, you can see, and you need to enable that Symantec authentication, or which we called root certificate. So this root certificate, why we use this controller certification authorization? This is to verify that the devices are properly set. So you can see Symantec automated, Symantec manual, and there is what we are going to use, which is called enterprise, our own root certificate. So we are going to paste the configuration here, and to paste the configuration here, we need to go inside my Windows Server. Obviously, again, I'm already in the Windows Server, and you need to type here localhost, okay, and cert SRV, okay, localhost / cert CRV. Okay, so you can see my local cert server is not enabled. So I have explained yesterday also that you need to go under the Windows Server. You can see add roles and features. Okay, and then it will ask you for next option. So you need to choose the role based on feature. Okay, so I'll choose this role based and then go and enable this. Okay, so there are multiple options here. Okay, so you go to here. So Active Directory and add features. So you can see enable the Active Directory certificate services and then go next. It will ask you these net frameworks, next, next. So you can see you need to enable these two options, guys. Okay, class is getting recorded, don't worry. You can follow these steps whenever you will access this lab, right? So when you turn on the Windows Server, you need to give the 5.4 IP. And after that, you need to follow the same steps to enable the certificate server. Okay, because to run this device, to configure this vManage, we have to authenticate this device. And we are not authenticating this device from the Symantec, which is Cisco by default. We are using our own certificate server. Okay, so certificate server is like, suppose you want to go abroad. Okay, suppose you want to go USA. So what exactly you are going to submit all your documents, right? And then the US, then the US embassy will give you a visa. Okay, it means they will give you the approval that you can visit USA, right? So the same way, this certification authority allows you to authenticate that this certificate is valid, and you are going to be, it is a signed certificate that yes, if my device is getting authenticated, they are genuine devices. We are not, because when you are on public, you are going to have connections with public VPNs, private VPNs. So this is mandatory to authenticate the all controllers. Ujjwal, you want to add something?
Yeah, you correctly said it. So the thing is, like even in case of, I remember we are having HTTP and HTTPS. So sometimes you have seen that when you type HTTPS, you see that certification is not valid. And then you say still trusted. So it means the certificate is not from some authorized some CA, authorized authority. That is why your system is giving error that this page is not having any valid certificate. So your browser is telling you that if you want to open this page, open on your risk, because this is not authorized by someone. Okay.
So in short, we need to authenticate. Right. Yeah. Let's make it simple that we need to add a root certificate. Okay.
Correct.
Yeah. So next. Okay. So you can see all the web server, everything will enable and install, and it will take just few minutes, maybe 1 or 2 minutes, so that so remember this Windows Server we are using for two things. One, so that we can access the vManager. Means we are using as a client machine also, that we can access this vManager. And the second role of with this Windows Server in my topology, that I'm going to authenticate this. I'm going to create this server as a root certificate server. So all my vManager, vSmart, vBond, all my devices are going to get the root certificate from this Windows Server. Okay, so ye teeno devices ko aapne authenticate karna hai. We need to authenticate all three devices with the root server, which is a certificate server, you can say that. Okay, so that because to make the things work in your lab, you need to create your own server. So you can see the Active Directory for the certification authority is getting installed, and everything will be very soon, it will be ready. Okay, so in short, guys, let me give you overview, like till then my devices are coming up. So we have two things, which is mandatory. Like if we talk about SD-WAN certificates, just hold on, let me check my own tablet. I hope you are actually increasing your interest in SD-WAN. Right, because we want to give the basic classes of SD-WAN so that you will actually know why we use SD-WAN and is it simple to learn or not. So SD-WAN, so you have two things. One is called a signed certificate. Okay, another thing is called like WAN Edge Authorized serial file. Okay, so these two things we need to have in our SD-WAN topology. Okay, so the signed certificate, this signed certificate is used to authenticate. It is used to authenticate devices, obviously. Okay, once it is authenticated, once the device is got authenticated, then device can establish connection. So devices will have secure sessions between each other. Okay, means all the devices are going to work together, right? We manage, we smart, we edge, everyone. So we need to install this signed certificate, then only the device is going to authenticate, and then only you are able to create the secure connections, secure sessions between vManager, vSmart, vBond, these devices. And all your vEdges, so this is vManager, this is vSmart, and this is what we call vBond, and over the internet and MPLS network, you have all your vEdges, right? So whatever number of branch offices you have, you need to have the authorized serial file. Then only these devices are going to register with the vManage. The first thing, we will have the signed certificate for on all the devices. So sabse pehle to hume sare devices ke andar signed certificate dalna hai. We need to have signed certificate in all the devices so that they will authenticate. And another thing is that we need to have the authorization serial file from the Cisco Smart Account. Yesterday, I discussed about Cisco Smart Account. So we will have the authorized serial file for all your vEdges. So this is for vEdges basically. All your vEdge devices will have the serial file, which will contain the serial number of all the vEdges. Okay, so I'll write here serial number for all vEdge devices. Okay, so very simple. So I'll take this into consideration. So next thing, like you can see here, where was my topology? Just hold on. That's Yeah. So now you can see almost my root server is installed, and let's try to open now. So now you can see here, localhost cert serves, there is some temporary error. Let me open in Chrome. So guys, we need to fix this, then only we are able to run the this. So localhost cert SRV. Okay, we need to see if any problem. So it is giving me some icon here. So you can see post deployment configuration is pending, configure again. So you can see this option credential, let's go ahead. And you need to enable this. Okay, standalone CA. So this CA means certification authority. So we are creating our own standalone certificate authority server. So which server you want to create, subordinate CA or root CA? So just you need to follow the root CA server. Okay, create a new private key. So you can follow the same steps. Everything is okay. So give 5 years validity, which is by default. I'm not doing any changes. I'm just following the same thing, which is giving the server is giving me the options. So yeah, you can see now the configuration is succeeded. And when we try to access this, so we got the local server. You can see Microsoft Active Directory certificate server. So you can see there are two options, like request a certificate when you click here. Okay, there is advanced certificate request. Click here. Okay, so this we are going to use when we are going to sign the normal. So as of now, you need to have the root certificate. So for this, you can go to this option, download a CS certificate. Okay, so you can see, you can choose this option base 64, and then you can see the download CS certificate. Okay, so you can see where you want to download. So I have downloaded in a folder. Okay, so let's rename this. This is for my root. This is for vManage certificate, vManage. And this is my root certificate. And once you download this certificate, you need to open this with the Notepad. Okay, so you can see this is the full certificate. So you are going to copy this. Okay, and go to this vManager. We need to go with the 192, yeah, here. And again, let me show you, go to the settings. Okay, in settings, there is controller certification authorization. So you need to choose this enterprise root certificate, and then we are going to paste the config. So you can see, and okay, so you can see certificate authorization. So you can see web server certificate, and there is a certificate, right? Yeah, so you can see we have added the certificate. And then go to this option, which is, I think, here in go to the certificates now. So under this configuration, you can see certificates. And when you see here, okay, so you can see still we are getting this no certificate installed. So it means there is an option called install certificate. Okay, let me paste here. Okay, but we need to add the signed certificate here. This is my root certificate. Okay, let's see. Yeah, this is, we need to raise the CSR request first. Okay, so we need to install the certificate here only first. here in the settings. There is option, Ujjwal, where is that? So I have uploaded the...
Yeah, so you have to raise a CSR request.
Yes, yes, yes. So under this edit option, like I have uploaded here, and we need to enable this set CSR properties, or we can ignore this?
No, we can ignore this.
Okay.
There itself, we can request the CSR. And then we have to sign it from the root, and then we have to upload.
Yeah, I know those options, but I'm just trying to access that. So once the certification authorization is activated, and then we need to download a root certificate, right?
Root certificate you have already uploaded.
Yeah, yeah. I need to raise the CSR. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. You have to raise.
So guys, what is CSR? That is certificate service request. So we need to raise the certificate raise request. And where is that option under certificates?
Yeah, under certificates.
Okay, I'll go to the controller. And I think this is the, right?
Yeah, yeah. No, no, just go to three buttons there.
Yeah, yes, got it. Actually, yeah. Sorry, guys, actually, it's... Oftenly, so you can see generate CSR, and now you can see it is giving me some options, begin certification request. So you can copy this. Okay. And then we go to our Active Directory and let's refresh this. Okay. Request certificate. Advanced certificate request. So right now what we have done, we uploaded a normal certificate called root certificate in the vManage, and now we are signing that certificate. Okay, understand there are two points. Like first, add root certificate. The first option was add root certificate, which is very simple. Okay, you like you follow the same step which I did earlier, and after that we are going to generate the CSR. Generate the CSR, that is service certificate service request. Okay. And then we are going to sign this certificate. This is normal certificate called root certificate. So remember, this is a certificate. I installed this into vManager. Okay. Now, once I added the root certificate in it, so I'm going to send a CSR. So this CSR request will go to my CA server, and CA server will sign it back. Okay, it is going to sign this certificate back so that it will authenticate. Okay, so this generate the CSR, and then we are going to download the CSR again, and we are going to install the signed certificate in vManage. Okay, so let's follow the steps. Don't worry. So you will understand. Don't worry. Okay, so it's not a rocket science. So advanced certificate request. You can see, and you need to go to this vManager. So this is my CSR request. I'm going to copy this. Okay, so this is my service request. I'm raising a request and submit. So you can see, please return to this website in day or two because your certification request is pending. But remember, we are admin. We are admin of this server. So we will go to our server manager. There under the tools, you will see certification authority. And now we have pending request from the customer that please, you can see pending request. So you can see this is the request which we need to permit. So you can see all task issue. So let's issue the certificate, and then we have issued the certificate. And if we try to reload this, okay, we go to the local certs CRV on the home page. Okay, so you can see here, view the status of pending service request. So now you can see the saved request set. Okay, let's download this. So under base 64 encoded. So we need to always follow the base 64 encoded version. Download a certificate. Again, we got downloaded. But this is my signed certificate. Remember, this is my vManage signed certificate. Signed cert. Okay, so again, now we are going to again open with the notepad. Okay, so I'm going to copy this. So now this is my signed certificate. Okay, ye sign ho chuka hai. This is authenticated certificate. And then I'm going to add install certificate. And then I'm going to paste this certificate. Install. And now, so let's wait for some time. And let's go to the certificates again. Controllers. Yeah, guys, can you see that vBond updated? And if you try to check the certificate serial number, that certificate is installed. Right? This is what we are going to follow for vSmart and for vBond. And once everything is done, then we need to add the serial file also. Okay. So let me repeat the steps again. Don't worry. So first, what I did, like I enable the certificate server. Okay. So once I activated the server, I'll go to this download a CS certificate and base 64. And then I download CS certificate. This is my root certificate. So once I download the root certificate, I open with Notepad, copy it, and then I come back to my vManager GUI. I'll go to the settings, administration. Then I'm going to paste the root certificate. Okay, so you can see where is that option, controller certification authorization, edit. And in the enterprise root certificate, I'm going to copy paste. So once you are going to copy paste the root certificate, you will now go to the certificate section under configuration, this wheel cycle. Okay, go to certificates and go to the controllers now. So the device will show you this vManage here, the system IP 1111. You will go to this three dots and you will generate CSR. So when you will generate CSR, okay, once you will generate the service certificate service request, then you need to go back here. You can see the home page again. Go to home page, request a certificate, advanced certificate request, and then you are going to copy paste that certificate information here, then submit it, and then you need to approve. And how to approve? Go to the server manager, go to the tools, certification authority. Okay, now go to this under option, pending request. Okay, so pending said, I think I have reloaded that. This is again giving me the thing. So go to all task and issue. So once you issue that certificate, go back again homepage, view the status of pending certificate request, and then download the signed certificate. So once you download the signed certificate, again, you go to the signed certificate, open with the notepad. Okay, copy paste this and now come back here. Okay, so install certificate here and paste it over here. And now the device will show you that the device got sync. And it will also show you the certificate serial number is here. Okay, vBond also updated. So everything is here. So now in the next step, in the next classes, because now you got the idea how we are going to do this lab and everything is possible, right? So we are going to add the devices here and we are going to add all our branch offices list here. You can see the certificate vEdge list. Okay. And we are going to add the serial numbers here in the list. Okay. So very soon we will show you all the configuration. And just have a look on vManage, like you can upgrade all your office devices from here. We can check the analytics. We can manage our users, if you have multiple engineers in office. So we'll discuss about these options as well. Okay, the most important sections, like when the devices are here, when the device will be here, right? So you can see upload WAN edge list, and there is a sync smart account also, but we are going to upload this WAN edge list, which we need to download it from vSmart, the smart account of Cisco. Okay, don't worry, like we are going to help you in every step as we discussed. So the candidates who are not received the lab access, like by tomorrow itself, they will be getting the lab access. Okay, we are going to create a WhatsApp group or maybe some Telegram or any type of chat group also. So if I'm available, I'm going to help. And if Ujjwal is available, we both are going to help you to do your labs. Okay, right, Ujjwal?
Yeah. Yeah. So only one point I would like to add. The certificate is that if we are having any hardware VH 1000 or 2000 edge, as we earlier discussed. So we don't require the certificate installation in those cases, because the hardware, if it is hardware VH, it is preloaded with the certificate.
So you are talking about the root certificate, or you are saying about the smart serial file?
Yeah. So there is a tamper proof chip in VH routers.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, like we are doing this CSR request, right? We are loading the root certificate and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Of VH, if it is hardware, then we don't require to upload any kind of certificate CSR request there. It will just because they would automatically signed by Symantec, and certificate is already there, so we don't have to upload any root certificate on the hardware VHS.
Okay, got it. So guys, this is the initial configuration which we are sharing. So like if you have 32 GB laptop, you can try this basic configuration. At least you got an idea how we are going to do this. Okay, Buzz. Okay, so I'm sharing this initial configuration file link with you all. Okay, if you have enrolled or not enrolled, this is consider. Okay, so this is the most important factor where everyone's stuck. They don't know how to do these things. Okay, so this is the file of PDF, like just open this link and we'll be getting the initial configuration. Okay, so certification authority is like you create as you submit your all documents, and the certification authority will give you the signed certificate. Okay, it's like you apply for your visa, and the embassy is going to stamp your visa so that you can visit all. You can visit that particular country. Okay, so certificate authority is important so that my devices will get authentication. Okay, so in the next class, hopefully we are going to activate all the devices and we will start working on the configuration part. Okay, so till the time, this week we are going to set up all the labs for all the candidates, and definitely you will not have any issue. It will be 24/7. And those who wants to enroll for this course. And the best part of this course is, guys, because as this is our first batch, so we do not want to take chances, because we want you to get the high value. So if you join this batch, you will be able to join the next batch also without any charge. Means it's like with a BOGO offer. Like if you join this SD-WAN batch, you'll be getting one more batch also, because we want you to train. And this is the first time NetworkInc is delivering the batch. So we do not want to take chance. We want you to actually train on SD-WAN. Okay, so it means you can attend two SD-WAN batches. Okay, and every candidate will get 50 hours of lab access, but we will not restrict only 50. If you complete your 50 hours, no issues. We can add 10, 15, 20 hours more. We will not restrict 2 hours, but we want everyone to learn. This is our agenda. Okay, and we have Ujjwal, who is having around 2 to 3 years experience for SD-WAN only. Okay, and I'm the trainer so that I can explain everything in a very easy way. And I think this is the best place to learn SD-WAN as of now. Okay. There are many videos available. There are many things. You can try it out. The things which we have trained in last 1 or 2 days, even these things are not easily available. Right, Ujwal? What do you think?
Yeah, that is correct. Actually, even the certificate thing, as you were explaining, it is not like easily available to everyone. If you are working in a production environment, then only you will get access to do all this stuff. Otherwise, if you are just going for any other courses, you will not get in detailed steps explanation as Atul has explained.
I do not share my personal number with anyone, but for this batch, because might be you have a lot of doubts that you want to go ahead with this batch and all. So I'm sharing my personal number with you all. If you have anything, if you want to join SD-WAN directly, you can contact me. Okay, no need to contact any team of mine, because this is little advanced thing. And if you need personal guidance from me that you want to go ahead with this or not, so you can contact me on the number which I've shared. This is my personal number. You can WhatsApp me also.